हेलो फ्रेंड्स, दिस इज़ बालाजी 2015 बैच IAS एंड ऑथर ऑफ अ प्रैक्टिकल अप्रोच टू एथिक्स इंटीग्रिटी एंड एप्टीट्यूड। आई प्रेज्यूम मोस्ट ऑफ यू हैव रेड माई बुक एंड रिटन दिस ईयर्स एग्जामिनेशन। द होल पर्पज़ बिहाइंड दिस वीडियो इज़ दैट एज इज सेड एथिक्स इज़ एवर इवॉल्विंग सब्जेक्ट। सो आई थॉट आई मीन एज अ रिस्पॉन्सिबल ऑथर आई शुड नॉट जस्ट स्टॉप एट राइटिंग द बुक एंड ऑल्सो कीप ऑन अपडेटिंग द एस्पिरेंट्स। And with regard to this year's ethics paper, I just intend to share a few insights. I believe such insights would help you people, ace exam in the next year for the aspirants preparing for next year, friends. Okay, before we start, I just want to tell you one thing. As I have always emphasized in multiple forums, it is your common sense with basic understanding of ethical terminology, added with your ability to express your ideas in crystal clear, precise language, makes you earn extremely exceptional marks in this exam. Okay, friends, relating to this year's paper, some general pointers which I want to place before all the aspirants is that the first key to success, to score above average marks in ethics, is your quick writing. Ethics expects you to write faster, and unless you finish the paper by writing fast, it would be extremely difficult for you to expect above average marks. Hence, the first and foremost tip I want to give to all the aspirants is to cultivate the habit of quick writing, without which it is not easy for you to finish the paper. If you don't finish the paper, take it from me that it is extremely difficult for you to end up getting above average marks. And the second important thing is always conceptualize ethics answer as being made up of several subcomponents. In the sense, your answer should be broken into 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 whatever subcomponents. Combining all those subcomponents should give a holistic answer, should give evaluator a holistic answer. So then what are the subcomponents, how to arrive at the subcomponents, perhaps I will discuss in the forthcoming slides. But I just want to emphasize one thing, that the whole idea behind breaking the answer into subcomponents is that evaluator will be forced to assign marks to each subcomponent necessarily. If you write without dividing your answer into subcomponents, then evaluator will not have any logical basis for awarding the marks. But if you have given 4 subcomponents, then evaluator may think, okay, he has given 4 different points. For everything, he may think, let us give 1.5 marks and you will end up getting 6 marks easily. Otherwise, with the same amount of content, same amount of words, you may not be able to convince evaluator to give you more marks. Hence, always try to express your answer as being sum of multiple subcomponents. And I understand that this may not be possible for each and every answer, but try to do it for at least 70 to 80% of answers, so that you would march ahead of your others, and you would easily place yourself in the interview and subsequently in the final list. And the third thing is, so many times ethics questions seem very general, but even if it seems general, it is very important to highlight the ethical terminology in the paper to convince the examiner that you are focusing on ethics. This ethics terminology need not be a very difficult jargons like deontology, teleology. Such things become too scholastic. But I would say ethics terminology means basically you should keep repeating terms like objectivity, integrity, impartiality, empathy, sympathy, corporate governance, transparency, accountability, citizens' charter, corruption, etc., etc. Such types of ethical terminologies you use more, your answer becomes more convincing, if I may say so. But always remember that this ethical terminology doesn't mean to bring very complex terms like teleology, deontology, etc., etc., etc. Okay. Then another point which I want to emphasize is that repetition of the theme of the question. Sometimes whatever is asked in the question, it is very important to explicitly link your every component, every argument to that theme, and that theme should be explicitly linked and explicitly expressed in the answer, so that examiner will get convinced that you have not gone away from the answer and you are writing trying to beat around the bush. Then the last one is examples, and I mean, if you have read my book, you would see I have tried to explain each and every concept only through examples. The advantage with examples is that it is very easy and it is very lively to read. At the same time, it is very lively to argue, and at the same time, no one would get bored. Everybody would say that, "Array, this fellow has not beaten around the bush." So it's important to focus on examples and to give real life examples of great personalities, or from your own life, or you can create hypothetical examples. So the field is yours, canvas is yours. I mean, whatever way you want to paint, you paint it. Now, okay, friends. Now let us come to the specific observations with regard to the ethics paper of 2020. A few general observations are that I mean, unlike previous year, some questions are directly asked from current affairs. Perhaps now henceforth it is important for aspirants to also think of ethical angles while preparing for current affairs in GS2 and GS3. So for example, in question number first and the second question in this year's ethics, it is very clear they had asked about comprehensive national power, and they had directly asked about national education policy. So unless you are aware of the main planks of these two concepts, it becomes slightly difficult to answer. Hence, it becomes important for those who are preparing for 2021 to think of ethical angle in every current affairs they do. This doesn't mean that you need to sit and start making notes for every current affairs from an ethical angle, but it just means that whenever you are seeing some news, you are coming across some news, try to think from ethics perspective. So for example, you see farmer laws, farmers' agitations, you can always think about civil society involvement in that, accountability of executive to the legislature, or accountability of even legislature to the public. So many, and the negotiation, the art of negotiation, the art of protest, I mean, stakeholder approach, etc. So many things will get linked. So my suggestion would be, whatever you see, try to link it with ethics. So that would actually help you mold your thinking. Perhaps it will also fetch you the required amount of knack to generate and churn more and more examples. Even if the questions don't get picked from such topics, even then you will be in a better position to use this indirectly as answers, as examples to your other answers, which will enrich your answer, which will make you good score extremely high marks. Then the relevance of the teachings of philosophers. So I mean, these days actually they have started asking about philosophers also, like Buddha, like Savitribai Phule, etc. So it's important to have basic understanding of the teachings of all the philosophers. And then coming to the case studies, I felt this year's case studies, few case studies were too bureaucratic, if I may say so, question number 7, because it was too much of like budget allocation, budget department, etc. Though it's a very simple case, but the moment you read it, you feel that it is filled with so bureaucratic jargons, you feel that you are out of place. It is very tough for you to put you in the place of that person and then think, but nonetheless, but it is important for you to understand that though it is worded in bureaucratic language, the underlying theme of the case study is to just your ethical competence. And another observation is that the more focus is on identifying the ethical issues rather than seeking solutions. Earlier the questions used to be more on options, like what are all the options available, which one will you choose, why. But this year's paper has given way to identification of more ethical issues. Perhaps henceforth you have to glean ethical issues in everything. That is what UPSC is expecting. You have to tune your mind to look for ethics in every news item you read, in every case you come across. And again, there is one case study which is directly picked from the current affairs, which is like migration crisis. So thus, I would say this year's ethics paper is like, it's totally based on common sense. The one who understands, I mean, at the cost of reputation, I say the one with solid understanding of ethical concepts, one with the ability to link those concepts with surroundings, the one with the ability to express all those things in his own words very precisely, can definitely write exceptional answers in this ethics paper also, and he can also score good marks. So that's it, let's move on. Friends, let us take the first question. The first question is, discuss the role of ethics and values in enhancing the following three major components of comprehensive national power: human capital, soft power, and social harmony. Friends, this is a question picked from current affairs, comprehensive national power. But nonetheless, the question is very clear. It talks about human capital, soft power and social harmony. Even if you are not aware of the concept of social comprehensive national power, even then you will be in a position to answer this very, very comfortably, because they have only given the three components: human capital, soft power and then social harmony. That's the beauty. Then friends, I was telling you that it is very important to present ethics as sum of subcomponents. Thus here they have only given three subcomponents. So your answer cannot be such that it is a single argument for human capital, soft power and social harmony, but it has to be separate. You have to specifically say how ethics and values help in enhancing the component of human capital, how ethics and values help in enhancing the component of soft power, how ethics and values would help in enhancing the component of social harmony. If you do that, there are three components that you have already given. For an examiner, he is forced to assign marks to each of these components and you will end up getting good marks. Again, in some questions actually you can again distinguish and say that the role of ethics in enhancing human capital, soft power and social harmony. Then you can separately take up the role of values in human capital, soft power and social harmony. But nonetheless, the problem is if you do that, the answer becomes too verbose, too elaborate, and maybe you will not be in a position to finish it in 150 words. It's not just important to write good answers, but it's important to finish the answer in the stipulated space available, stipulated words given. Hence, it is better to treat this ethics and values as a single thing and then try to address how these two would help in human capital, how these two would help in soft power and how this would help in social harmony. Okay, let's get into the answer, friends. First, anyway, you have to write about comprehensive national power. See friends, I am telling you, even if you are not aware of the, you have not read about comprehensive national power, still using your common sense, you can arrive at the answer. See, you know what is power. Power is ability to influence, right? So it is national power. Comprehensive national power is nothing but it is ability to influence other countries' policies. It's as simple as that. Then you have to say how ethics through human capital would help a country to influence other countries. How ethics through soft power would help a country to influence other countries. How ethics through social harmony would help a country to influence other countries. That is what would make your answer. And then let's start, friends. So then actually I've already told you three given components have to be addressed separately and it has to be linked to CNP. I have told you in my initial slide itself that it is important, extremely important to repeat the theme of the question all through. Okay, then first component is human capital. Again, for the sake of making examiner comfortable, for the sake of convincing him, I have again divided human capital into healthy, educated and ethical populace. Then I am saying how ethics would build a healthy capital, healthy human capital. Thus, see, it is possible through ethics in doctors, ethics in private medical sector. If the doctors are ethical, they treat well. If the private sector, medical sector follows the principles of ethics, then they would not overcharge, then the out of expenditure come down, there would not be unnecessary bills and there would be proper treatment at affordable rate, affordable healthcare is possible. And similarly, dedication to service. So, if this ethics would help create so many free medical camps, free medical services, that would help people services at free of cost or easily without spending much of money. And also ethics on the part of private businesses like food industry and pharma industry would also help, would definitely help build health. For example, if the food industry doesn't have ethics, then they would resort to food adulteration. That will put health at risk, public health at risk. If the pharma industry doesn't follow ethical protocols and they would risk the lives of the people. That's how it is important for private businesses to have ethics to build ethical human capital. You can give the example of Baba Amte, who dedicated his life to the emancipation of lepers. Then I also, how the, I mean now, I have explained what is ह्यूमन कैपिटल, हेल्थी ह्यूमन कैपिटल, देन यू हैव टू टॉक अबाउट हाउ इट वुड हेल्प. यू हैव टू लिंक इट टू कॉम्प्रहेंसिव नेशनल पावर. हियर हेल्थ टूरिज्म, यू आर अवेयर दैट सो मेनी पाकिस्तानी सिटीजन्स किड्स कम एंड गेट देयर हार्ट सर्जरीज डन इन प्लेसेस लाइक नारायण हृदयालय ऑफ बैंगलोर. दैट इज हाउ यू आर एबल टू इन्फ्लुएंस. So without this ethics on the part of doctors in Narayan Hrudayalaya, without ethics, this would not have been possible, right? This is possible only because of that ethics in human capital. Then comes educated. The human capital has to be educated. So again the same thing, ethics in teachers, ethics in private schools. So if both follow the ethics, then perhaps we have a better aware citizens, we have a better educated, better populace. And again, the service in education, free service in education would bring lot of changes in the lives of disadvantaged sections. A provision of free education, for example, Siddhaganga Mutt in Tumkur district of Karnataka, which is very famous. Even Abdul Kalam and all, they have all visited and they have all praised the provision of free education to the marginalized communities. And you can give examples of your choice, but it is just the example that I knew and I have quoted. So thus, and the ethical, education would imbibe the value of patriotism and it make ethical citizens also. Thus, ethics in education would promote our human capital. Then if that, how does that human capital build CNP is my next question. That is obviously, for example, so many African students come and study in India, right? If not for ethics in education, if not for ethics in education leading to better human capital in India, Africans would never have looked up to India. Thus, ethics in education has helped build human capital, which in turn has improved the comprehensive national power. So, and the next is soft power. First one is human capital, second one is soft power. In soft power, they only have given two things, policies and culture. They have only given two more subcomponents. Ethical practices are accepted and embraced. You know, Ashoka could wield influence over Maldives and Sri Lanka only through Buddhism, which is an ethical practice, which is an ethical culture. Thus, an ethical society can influence the other societies. An ethical society can build, can increase the comprehensive national power of other countries. So then similarly comes policies. For example, if the policies are ethical, those policies are replicated and adapted by other countries also. For example, Bolsa Familia cash transfer policy, it has influenced India. In fact, that is the whole reason behind direct benefit transfer scheme that has been introduced in order to plug the leakages in public, in so many welfare schemes. And similarly, the SHG movement of Bangladesh has influenced India thanks to Muhammad Yunus. So, because of his yeoman efforts, actually the SHG movement in was a runaway hit and it brought women empowerment in Bangladesh, and the same thing has been replicated in so many states in India, and that is actually doing wonders. So, thus Bangladesh, a country like Bangladesh, imagine a small country like Bangladesh, which is still very much underdeveloped, could influence India. Their ethical, their national, comprehensive national power was accentuated, was increased, was multiplied by their ethical policy of women empowerment through SHGs, self-help groups. That was actually, they have they could influence a country like India, imagine. So, thus it helps. Next, the last thing is social harmony. So, social harmony, the idea is with tolerance, respect to all, empathy with all would lead to a peaceful coexistence of all communities and thus results in social harmony. See, again friends, this helps a given nation to focus on strengthening one's position in international politics. Assume we are living in a country where there is no social harmony, where always the communities are pitted against each other, always linguistic, racial, regional, religious communities are pitted against each other, then the country has to focus exclusively on bringing down that disharmony and to inculcate that social harmony. And they will be left with very little money and energy to focus on international politics. The social harmony is very, very, very important. Friends, I want to again, thus actually this will help increase our comprehensive national power. Friends, I also want to emphasize that, see, in the entire answer, I have tried my best to give ethical terminology and have tried my best to link everything explicitly to the question. So, for example, see here, tolerance, respect to all, empathy, all these things are ethical terminologies. See here, I have clearly said Ashoka could wield influence over Sri Lanka and Maldives only through Buddhism, which is based on eightfold paths that are nothing but ethical tenets. So, I have tried. Examiner should never feel that you have written an irrelevant example. Maybe with some idea you have written an example, but it is not necessary that the examiner would also think in the same way and would think your way and award you marks. There is always a possibility that his thinking would be like, "Arey, how is it related? It is religious, it is not ethical." Then it is important for you to connect. So, it is based on eightfold path that are nothing but ethical tenets. So, it's important, friends, to link, to repeat the theme of the question and to link everything to the question. So, okay friends, let's come to the second question. Second question is about education. It is picked from the new education policy. So, the question is again like the question itself presents before you two components: all round development of an individual and social transformation. Again, this all-round development can be divided into physical development, intellectual development and moral development. This is not given anywhere, friends. It is just my way. As I told you already, it is very important to present answer as being made of different components in order to convince examiner. So, that's how these three, things have been made. And see, physical development, again, special emphasis on physical education teachers to be recruited for school complexes, 4-year B.Ed. with specialization in physical education, and intellectual also, like bringing, you are very well aware that they want to bring 3 to 6 years age under schooling system so that the brain development during that time would be good, and they also have envisaged multidisciplinary graduate education. So, all these things would, and anyway, there is the national education policy talks so much about building ethical traits, moral traits, so there is special emphasis on ethical traits. And also 360 degree holistic assessment rather than scholastic assessment through examination is what new education policy wants to implement. Again, for social transformation, now they have gender inclusion fund in order to bring more women into the children, girls into schools, and also special focus on disadvantages sections like tribals, SCs, STs, women, physically challenged, etc., etc. Friends, before I move to the next question, just I want to tell you, see, all these things you need not have to even read new education policy. Of course, you would have read, I know, because it was a very important topic for your GS2 also. But what I am just trying to tell you is, these are the things based on your common sense. Anyway, anybody even without preparation would know that they want to bring the preschool under schooling system. This you would anyway write. And the remaining things are like special emphasis on physical education, etc., etc., can be written from your common sense also. Because new education policy is also emerged from someone's common sense. So, I firmly believe, and it is good to read. If someone who has not read the new education policy, that fellow should not just say that, "Arey yaar, that topic I had missed, but now the question has come, I am not able to answer." That thought should never creep into anyone's mind. At that time, you apply your common sense and you have your answer, friends. So, this is possible. Okay friends, now the next question is, hatred is destructive of a person's wisdom and conscience that can poison a nation's spirit. Do you agree with this view? Justify your answer. Friends, again there are two components in this: person's wisdom, person's conscience. So, you have to specifically write how the hatred would spoil one's, would destroy one's wisdom, how it would destroy one's conscience, and how it would spoil or how it would poison a nation's spirit. That is important. And again, they are asking, do you agree with this view? Justify your answer. Okay, of course, just want to tell one very important thing. Whenever you have to take a stand, whether you have to agree or not, it is very important to take that stand that offers you more arguments. You have more points to write. Of course, sometimes, of course, the answer would be obvious where even with less arguments also you have to say yes. Just as in this question, you can never say that hatred is not destructive of a person's wisdom. You are tied up, but still, I am just saying in some other question, sometimes if you can take either of the stands, means please take that stand which has so many arguments to make, so that you would get more marks, that's it, nothing wrong. Okay, now First one, I mean, for answering this question, you should understand what is nation's spirit. Basically, nation spirit is feeling of belonging to a nation and also to have that unity with everyone. So, if you understand this, then it becomes very easy to answer this question. Then, what are the two components? As I told you, person's wisdom and person's conscience. How hatred is destructive of a person's wisdom? Again, answering it as a whole, it is very important to give it under two heads. One is destructive of person's wisdom and destructive of person's conscience. What is wisdom? So, finally, it's an innate ability to understand things. So, that's reasoning. Basically, this hatred would cloud one's reasoning. How? Because we have seen WhatsApp messages enraging people to pick fights with other communities without verifying the veracity, that is truthfulness of those messages. This happens only if you have hatred, right? Thus, by seeing some WhatsApp message and you get angered about other community, then where do you, you don't have a feeling of belonging to the nation, then you have a feeling of belonging to a community. Thus, the nation spirit is poisoned. That is how hatred is destructive of a person's wisdom. One person hates the other, a person from one religious community hates the person from other religious community. Then he has more belonging to his community, not to the nation. Then the wisdom is lost, then the hatred has taken the place. Then destructive of a person's conscience. What is conscience? It's your inner voice. But if you have hatred, you don't listen to your inner voice, because it clouds your ethics. For example, if you don't like people from a person from some other region, you are taking an interview, then you would not select that person. You are forced to select against your conscience. Hatred would make you select the person belonging to your region, even though the other person from other region was more qualified, more competent, more deserving to the job. So thus, in both the cases, it destroys a person's wisdom, it destroys a person's conscience. Then you don't have sense of belonging to the nation, you have a sense of belonging to a particular region, community, religion, whatnot. So thus, you can justify your answer. So friends, what I am just trying to tell you is, you have to divide your answer into two components and offer arguments for both, and your answer is beautiful. Friends, this question is self-explanatory, it is very straightforward, so I don't want to dwell much on this. It talks about four main components of emotional intelligence, and it is asking, can they be learned or not? So you please write four components: self-awareness, self-regulation, social skills, empathy and motivation, and you just say whether they can be learned or not. So obviously, I would say my stand is they can be learned. If you have other stand with more arguments, you can very well argue that it cannot be learned, but I feel it's very easy to argue self-awareness, how it can be learned, social self-regulation, how it can be learned, etc. So, just given a few points. So, self-awareness, it can be learned through introspection, talking to others, be open-minded, by being open-minded. Self-regulation is can be learned by not acting in haste, by meditation. Social skills can be learned through developing a sense of humor, art of praising, keeping in touch with others. Empathy, of course, you can learn it through spending time with other weaker sections, understanding about their lives, etc. Motivation, of course, like you can read about the autobiographies, biographies of great persons, read motivational stories, watch actually TED Talks, etc., etc. That's how you can develop, you can learn it. So, this is my take on it. So, it's a straightforward question. So, don't want to spend much time on it, friends. Thank you. Again, friends, this is also a straightforward question. I don't want to spend much time on it. It is talking about what teachings of Buddha are most relevant today and why. Of course, friends, it is very, at that point of time, you should be smart enough. Whatever teachings of Buddha that strike your mind at that point of time in the examination, you should argue them to be the most relevant, and you should give one or two arguments for that. I personally felt, all of us know the Eightfold Path of Buddha. You would have studied for GS1, also for prelims. So, same thing you can write. What are all the eightfold paths and how they are relevant even today? So thus, how right understanding is important. So it says actually desire is the reason for all the sorrow. Now we are seeing corporate greed leading to corruption, misappropriation of funds. Thus it is, without right understanding only, people are indulging in all corrupt practices here. So if that right understanding comes, of course, I think the paper of ethics becomes redundant, just for the Okay, next, right thought, actually thought only leads to action. So thus, if a person has ethical thoughts, then obviously he will not indulge in unethical thing. Then why right speech is important, non-lying, not being rude, and this is what is being taught in corporate companies, like companies, right? Like communication skills, negotiations in international relations, they become important even today. Then right action, that's what, right? Non-violence, justice, etc., etc. Those right actions are the basic ethical tenets that we are saying. You can give a number of examples. Then right livelihood. You have to do right livelihood. That is why there is a prohibition on prostitution. There is a prohibition on, immoral trafficking of human beings. There is a prohibition on hoarding. There is a prohibition on smuggling, etc., etc. Thus, it is relevant even today. Friends, like this also, you can write even the remaining three. Relevance of the remaining three teachings of the Buddha. Somehow I have missed it in PPT, but I think I have made my concept very clear, made my approach very clear, that you have to pick everything and you have to argue how relevant, how important it is. Okay, friends, the next question is, the will to power exists, but it can be tamed and be guided by rationality and principles of moral duty. Examine the statement in the context of international relations. Again, friends, you can split this question into how rationality can tame the will to power, how principles of moral duty can tame will to power. But I think since I have explained that already in that approach in two to three questions already, I thought of taking a different approach so that it is, I mean, you would exam may, you can choose any approach of your choice. So here, friends, I thought, okay, now again I have divided the answer into components in a different way. So ethics is determined by national interest, non-interference into sovereignty of other nations, and interest of mankind. So the basic thing is, what is this interest of mankind? Interest of mankind encapsulates the principles of rationality and principles of moral duty. So if you keep interest of mankind in view, then you would not allow national interest to override interest of mankind, and you would not get carried away by the greed to power. Similarly, if interest of mankind is kept in mind, you will also be mindful of non-interference into the sovereignty of other nations. Thus, you can very well argue that though the will to power exists, it can very well be tamed by rationality and principles of moral duty. That is the whole concept of international conventions, international bodies, international agreements, protocols, everything, friends. You can very well give the example of nuclear non-prohibition treaty, because that will to power exists, will to capture every country, will to hold power over every nation exists, but it is tamed by the rationality and the moral duty principles underlying in that non-prohibition treaty, NPT. Similarly, it is applicable for chemical weapons, biological weapons, everything, right? If that is not, that will to power existed in its lonely, without rationality and principles of moral duty, now people would have used nuclear weapons, biological weapons, and the humanity would have been vanished by now. So thus, you can think like that and you can argue like that. Friends, again a straight question. I don't want to spend much time on this. Distinguish between laws and rules. You know what is law, what is rule. You will write on your own. Discuss the role of ethics in formulating them. The best thing is ethics in the formulation of law. Laws have to be non-discriminatory. Ethics, the most important ethical tenet is impartiality and non-discrimination, and you try to ensure incorporate in the formulation of laws. And you ethic, I mean, laws themselves prohibit so many unethical behavior, and laws also reinforce compassion towards weaker sections. Similarly, ethics in the formulation of rules. Of course, friends, there is very thin line of difference between laws and rules, but for the sake of making it two components, you can write it separately. 2 points you can write for laws, and remaining 2-3 points you can write it for rules. That's how you convince the evaluator that your answer is multidimensional. So here, the ethics in the formulation of rules is, it should spirit the ethical spirit of law, of course, because rules should always be in tandem with the law. So it has to reflect the ethical spirit of law, and also it should not promote selfish interest. Of course, friends, even laws also should not promote selfish interest. But rather than putting that point under formulation of laws, I have put it under formulation of rules, so that I have a few points there and a few points here, and I can convince the examiner that my answer is multidimensional. So, friends, I just want to emphasize another thing. See my answer. I have used the word non-discriminatory, prohibition of unethical behavior, compassion towards weaker section, not to promote selfish interest, ethical spirit. Everywhere I have tried to use ethical terminology. Please stick to that in your exams as well. Thank you. Okay, friends, this actually talks about what contributes to a positive attitude in a person. Though this question initially talks about civil servant, but later the question is very simple. It is straightforward about what contributes to a positive attitude in a person. Again, for the sake of making the answer look like being made up of various components, I have divided it into what social factors would contribute, what economic factors, psychological factors, and what political factors. Again, under social factors, you have family and peers, Vivekananda's family. And for peers also, if you think, you get so many examples. For economic factors also, financial self-reliance is something that gives so much confidence and positive attitude to a civil servant. That is the whole reason why government offers civil servant a very handsome salary along with so many concomitant perks and facilities. And also, ample opportunity to do indulge in economic pursuit is something that gives a lot of self-confidence to anybody, for that matter, that gives a lot of positivity also. That is the whole reason why civil servant can go to international assignments and all, actually. Similarly, psychological factors, which are again self-explanatory, personality, composure, his habits and situation, etc. And again, political factor, democracy. It is democracy that gives positive attitude. Without democracy, you don't have fundamental rights, you don't have right to free speech, expression, etc. Then you always live under tremendous pressure, stress. You will never be positive in life, actually. Thus, this question I have tried to bundle it in social factors, economic factors, psychological factors, and political factors. That's it. Okay, what are the main factors responsible for gender inequality in India? Friends, again, a self-explanatory. But as I told you in the previous question, again, I have tried to make it as what are the social factors that are responsible, economic factors that are responsible, political factors that are responsible. Anyway, this is self-explanatory. I don't want to dwell much on it. And the second part of the question is, discuss the contribution of Savitribai Phule in this regard. Friends, all of us are aware, though you have not read about Savitribai Phule, please attempt this question. All of us are aware that she is the first female teacher in India. Female teacher in the sense, she is the first one who promoted female education. She is the first one to start a female school for girls. She was the first one to roam, house to house, to motivate parents to send girls to the school. So these are some of the things that she has contributed. These things we know. Even if you know also, you can very well say that she struggled very hard for emancipation of girls. She motivated girls to schools. She herself taught to so many girls and made them educated, etc., etc. So it's also self-explanatory. So nothing much to offer. Okay, friends. And the another question is, the current internet expansion has instilled a different set of cultural values, which are in conflict with traditional values. Discuss. Of course, friends, again, a question based on common sense and our understanding of the surroundings and how the life is evolving. And friends, there are two ways in which you can answer. You can very well say, what are the reasons for current internet? What are the reasons or how internet expansion has led to new cultural values? Second thing, what are those few cultural values that are in conflict with traditional values? Maybe there may be some values which are not in conflict with traditional values. Those things we need not have to touch, friends. Okay, first let us take reasons. This is the first component for our answer. The thing is, of course, now we are getting so much exposed to other societies through movies, documentaries, etc. And another thing is, we have direct virtual interaction with people from other societies through social media. We have friends across the world on FB, Facebook, WhatsApp, Twitter. We follow so many people, etc. Thus, we get to know how others live, and that is how we start getting influenced. And some of such influences may be in the conflict with our traditional values. What are those new values? Individualism versus collectivism. Second one is live in relationships versus marriage. bodily autonomy versus marriage, adventurism versus status quoism, free sexual choices versus heterosexual sexuality. So these are all the things. I mean, of course, I have given you the pointers, and I am sure you will take it, you will understand those things, and you will incorporate them in your answer. And the last thing is, however, it is important you can conclude stating that some traditional values are still intact, like respect to parents, etc., etc., something like that. So, to some extent, even community living is still intact in India. So, all those things you can, in the conclusion, you can very well say that though the internet has instilled a different set of cultural values, our basic fabric of our culture is still intact. Something like that you can very well conclude to give an alternate thought at the end. So, your success lies in churning out these new values, friends. What are the new values that have come because of internet expansion is something which you have to think. And that exam, I mean, at that time, if you are able to think and churn out these values, explanation will not take much of a time. You will write, I know. So, thus, let us move on to the next question, friends. Here, the question is about quotes, friends. You are aware what does these quotes mean to you is what they ask. Condemn none. If you can stretch out a helping hand, do so. If not, fold your hands, bless your brothers and let them go their ways. Swami Vivekananda. The basic understanding is that you don't oppose even if you cannot support someone. At least let people who are doing good work, allow them to do rather than putting a spanner into their works. How can you make it, what does it mean to you? You can answer it as being made up of three components again, friends. At individual level, what does that mean? At organizational level, what does that mean? At national level, what does that mean? At individual level, you can very well quote the example of Dashrath Manji. Dashrath Manji was actually trying to remove a boulder which was obstructing way to his village. Everybody ridiculed him, but his hard work for over 20 years led to the formation of a road. Those people, if they had not supported, at least they should not have ridiculed him, but they ridiculed. So, that is one angle. Next, at organizational level, when Facebook was redefining the area of social media, court cases were slapped against Zuckerberg. All of us know, we have watched in the movie Social Networking. So, thus, if you don't support, at least don't try to put spanner into others' works. Then again, at national levels, we know unmindful and non-constructive criticism by opposition parties against even well-thought-out, well-reasoned government schemes. So, thus, friends, by making your answer like what does this quote mean to you at individual level, what does this quote mean to you at organizational level, what does this quote mean to you at national level, would definitely fetch you more marks rather than just writing answer at one stretch. You divide answer into three components. Even if examiner gives 1.5 marks to each of the three components, you have 4.5, which is an amazing score. Another quote is, the best way to find yourself is to lose yourself in the service of others. So, again, you have to make it as being made up of various components, friends. Service, to lose yourself in the service of others. That means, how do you help others at home? How do you help others at school? How do you help others in society? Three components you can very well write. So, this need not have to be something like big service. You can very well say that you can helping your mother cut vegetables in her kitchen, helping your father in cleaning his two-wheeler, helping your siblings in their assignments, etc., is as good as losing yourself in the service of others, friends. Again, in the schools, how do you involve in the community activities like national service scheme, scouts, etc.? How do you support friends who are from poorer background or friends who have drive to learn but they are not able to understand a few things? How do you help them? Is again losing yourself in the service of others. At the society level, of course, you can quote the examples of Mother Teresa, Baba Amte. I mean, so many examples abound, friends. So, thus, rather than just writing about that quote, you can just divide that quote, divide your reflections on that quote at three different levels. Home, school, society would enrich your answer and would convince the examiner that your answer is better than others and you would get good marks, friends. Okay, let's go to the next quote. Then the last question before case studies is that, what does the following quote mean to you? A system of morality which is based on relative emotion. Quote which is based on relative emotional values is a mere illusion, a thoroughly vulgar conception which has nothing sound in it and nothing true. I mean, of course, friends, it's also a very straightforward question, nothing much to say. What is the meaning of morality? Morality should be, the basic understanding of this question is that morality should be based on rationality, it should not be based on emotions or whims and fancies. So again, you can divide, divide your answer as being made up of two parts, morality based on rationality, morality based on relative emotional values. So first you can say morality, how morality based on rationality is important is true. And again you can disprove how morality based on relative emotional values is just a vulgar conception. So morality based on rationality is that, for example, girls shall be treated on par with boys. But morality based on relative emotional values, practice of sati, it is based on the emotional value that widow would become prey to men's lust. That is the whole reason why the forefathers wanted the women to get into the funeral pyre of the husband. So thus it was based on the relative emotion, it was not based on the rationality, it was not based on the fact that she also had right to leave. So thus you can divide your answer. First you can, or I mean, you can first say why morality based on relative emotional values is not sound, and again you can again argue why morality based on rationality is true. So that's how you can divide this into two components, friends. Okay friends, now the case study. It says Rajesh Kumar is a senior public servant with reputation of honesty and forthrightness, currently posted in finance ministry as head of budget division. His department is presently busy in organizing budgetary support to the states, four of which are due to polls within the financial year. This year's annual budget had allocated 8,300 crores for national housing scheme, a centrally sponsored social scheme for the weaker sections of society. Rupees 775 crores have already been drawn for the NHS till June. The Ministry of Commerce had long been pursuing a case for setting up a special economic zone in the southern state to boost exports. After 2 years of detailed discussion between the center and state, the Union Cabinet approved the project in August. Processes was initiated for land acquisition. 18 months ago, a leading PSU had projected the need for setting up a large natural gas processing plant in a northern state for the regional gas grid. The land is already in possession of PSU. The gas grid is an essential component of the national energy security. After 3 rounds of global bidding, the project was allotted to an MNC. The first tranche of payment to the MNC is scheduled to be made in December. Finance Ministry was asked for a timely allocation of an additional 6,000 crores for these two development projects. It was decided to recommend reappropriation of this entire amount from NHS allocation. The file was forwarded to the Budget Department for their comments and further processing. On studying the file, Rajesh Kumar realized that this reappropriation may cause inordinate delay in execution of National Housing Scheme, a project much publicized in the rallies of senior politicians. Correspondingly, non-availability of finances would cause financial loss to the SEZ and national embarrassment due to delayed payment in the international project. Rajesh Kumar discussed the matter with seniors. He was conveyed that it is politically sensitive situation, needs to be processed immediately. Rajesh Kumar realized that diversion of funds from the NHS could raise difficult questions for the government in the parliament. Then what are the first question, friends? What are the ethical issues involved in reappropriation of funds from a welfare project to a development project? Very tricky question. You need to think there and you need to answer, friends. The first thing is, superiors have directed him to allocate. Whether the first ethical dilemma or an ethical issue which Rajesh Kumar faces now is whether superior directive versus welfare of weaker sections. And the second thing is very important, friends, because the question is ethical issues involved in reappropriation of funds from welfare project to the development project. The what is welfare project? It talks about inclusive development. What is other projects? They are talking about overall economic development. The dichotomy between these two is the ethical issue. And the third ethical issue is socialism versus capitalism. National health housing scheme is a socialism brainchild, and gas grid and SEZ is capitalism brainchild. And again, the regionalism also comes into picture, because the two projects, one project is in southern state and another project is in northern state. How will you allocate the funds and how will you do it? So these are some of the broad ethical issues, and of course, friends, the list is just not exhaustive, it is just indicative. You can come up with n number of ethical issues. I am just giving some tips. So okay, this question is important, friends. Given the need for proper utilization of public funds, discuss the options available to Rajesh Kumar. Is resigning a worthy option? So again, first one is you have to discuss the options available to Rajesh Kumar, and then you should say is resigning a worthy option or not. Of course, the first option is as directed, you please divert the money from national health scheme to other schemes. Second option is diverting, you divide the money available into three projects: National Housing Scheme, Gas Grid, and then SEZ. And one third you keep it for NHS, and remaining one third each you give it to other projects. That is another option. Third option is divert less to SEZ, more to Gas Grid, yet maintain some allocation to NHS. This is because for Gas Grid already land acquisition has started, the project is about to kick off. SEZ, the land acquisition itself will take a lot of time. What is the option four? Option four says divert other funds allocated for non-essential projects, raise loan for funding these two development projects, and resort to option three only if these two fail. I would select the option four, friends. Don't, I have always said you should, I think even if you read my article on Insights on India on ethics strategy, which I wrote about 4 years back, you should always choose a stand that will try to harmonize between the extremes. It's Buddha's middle path, if I may say so. Here also, what I would say, there may be some other non-essential projects. You try to pick money from those non-essential projects and try to give it to SEZ and try to give it to Gas Grid some money. And or you can, since they are all economic ventures, Gas Grid will generate your revenue. At the same time, SEZ will also generate your revenue. Since the revenue generation is there, why don't you look for options of raising loans from international bodies? Or why don't you look for an option of PPP where private sector will put some money into it? Only if those options fail, then you should go for the third option. If you write something like this, fourth option, friends, this is actually what to say, out of the box option, which I always feel. Okay, that means you have thought from all the directions, and you are saying if the other alternatives close, then you will go to the second best option. This very, very few aspirants write, friends. And again, the last thing is resigning a worthy option? Of course, friends, you are all aware resigning is never a worthy option for anything, because you have to take a decision. Why should you think that it is? I mean, resignation is a very big thing. So that is not at all a worthy option. So this is how you can approach this question. Of most of you would end with option one, or I mean you would think, okay, I would divert the money or I would not divert the money. So most of you, though you think to divert the money, but think how you can do it judiciously, how you can do it scientifically. If you write something like this, of course your answer stands out, friends. The chairman of Bharat Missiles Limited was watching a program on TV wherein Prime Minister was addressing the nation on the necessity of developing a self-reliant India. He subconsciously nodded in agreement and smiled to himself as he mentally reviewed BML's journey in the past 2 decades. BML had admirably progressed from producing first-generation anti-tank guided missiles to designing and producing state-of-the-art ATGM weapon systems that would be the envy of any army. He sighed in reconciliation with his assumptions that the government would probably not alter the status quo of a ban on export of military weaponry. To his surprise, the very next day he got a telephone call from the Director General, Minister of Defence, asking him to discuss the modalities of increasing BML production of anti-tank guided missiles, as there is a probability of exporting the same to a friendly country. The Director General wanted the chairman to discuss the details with his staff in the Delhi next week. 2 days later, at a press conference, Defence Minister stated that he aims to double the current weapons export levels within 5 years. This would give an impetus to financing the development and manufacturing of indigenous weapons in the country. He also stated that all indigenous arms manufacturing nations have a very good record of international arms trade. So, friends, now the next question is, as an arms exporter of a responsible nation like India, what are the ethical issues involved in the arms trade? What are the ethical issues, friends? So now it's just common sense again. It is against the principle of non-violence. It may attack innocent civilians. It may generate fear, psychosis. Money spent on arms, which could otherwise have gone towards other development activities. These are some of the ethical issues. You can very well come up with more ethical issues. I don't want to delve much into it because it is again self-explanatory. Next question, friends. List five ethical factors that would influence the decision to sell arms to foreign government. Friends, they have asked five. You should write five. You should think and write, actually. All of us are aware, no first use policy. You should put that condition. Then again, not against civilians. not against agriculture crops, storage points of food and medicines and other essentials. Again, minimum usage for engendering only deterrence. The last point is not to sell to any third country that may violate the above four conditions. These are the five ethical factors that should influence the decision to sell arms to foreign governments, right? Only those countries that would adhere to all these conditions I should be able to sell. So that, again friends, I just want to link this to that previous question that talked about the will to power should be guided and tamed by rationality and principles of moral duty. So if you do that, actually you want to establish yourself as an arms exporter, you want to strengthen your economy, but even then you are not going beresk, you are not going irrationally, you are putting those conditions that would preserve the interest, ethical interest of yours as well as interest of mankind. You are not letting your national interest to ride over the interest of mankind, friends. So thus, these are some of the principles, and I want to draw your attention to the fifth principle, friends. Sometimes actually this is a kind of thing you may have seen in my previous case study also. I also said that if I would explore some more options, if they don't work, I will go for option 3. Here also similar kind of a thing. You should not sell it to a third country that would violate the above four options. Something like that you can write, which will make your answer really out of the box and fetch you good marks. 9th question, friends. Rampuraya, remote district inhabited by tribal population, is marked by extreme backwardness and abject poverty. Agriculture is the mainstay of the local population, though it is subsistence due to the very small land holdings. There is insignificant industrial or mining activity. Even the targeted welfare programs have inadequately benefited the tribal population. In this restrictive scenario, the youth has begun to migrate to other states to supplement the family income. Plight of minor girls is that their parents are persuaded by labor contractors to send them to work in BT cotton farms of a nearby state. The soft fingers of the minor girls are well suited for plucking the cotton. The inadequate living and working condition in these farms have caused serious health issues for minor girls. NGOs in the districts of domicile and the cotton farms appear to be compromised and have not effectively exposed the twin issues of child labor and development. You are appointed as a district collector of Rampura. Identify the ethical issues involved. Which specific steps will you initiate to ameliorate the conditions of minor girl and also to improve the overall economic scenario? The first question is identify the ethical issues involved. What are the ethical issues involved, friends? We know it is child labor. Child labor comes with loss of education to those kids. And again, next, exploitation of labor, which is against the dignity of labor and it is against the bodily autonomy of minor girls. I just want to draw your attention to the phrase bodily autonomy, friends. Such terms will make examiner feel that you have written an ethical answer, not a general answer. And of course, there is definitely scope for child abuse and civil society mutism, friends. It is very surprising that civil society is not raising any voice against it. So there is corruption and compromise of values there. These are some of the ethical issues. And the next, they have asked for steps to ameliorate the conditions of minor girls and also to improve overall economic scenario. With regard to steps to ameliorate the minor girls, friends, I have again written some again component subcomponent strategy approach. So you have to have separate residential school for girls where you have to provide nutritious food, high quality coaching in tribal dialect. It's a tribal district, friends. There should be scope for sports development, incentive for compensating loss of wages, otherwise parents will not send them to schools. Awareness about sexual autonomy and some other points are actually missing, friends. Actually, you can also talk about skill training to the girls. You can also speak about so many other things like regular checkup for the girls. And I think, friends, another issue is overall economic scenario of the district. That also has somehow got missed in the slide. So overall economic scenario, how do you wish to develop in this? Actually, it's a tribal district. So you can promote, it is more based on agriculture. You can very well implement the scheme MGNREGS. The first thing that you can do is MGNREGS scheme that will provide local employment. The provision of local employment is a rightful entitlement to every beneficiary is there. Then again, you can there is no industrial and mining activity. It's a tribal area. The land would be cheap. It is very easy to attract some industrial powers and set up the forums there. And again, since it's a tribal area and there is some agriculture, it would be better if you come up with some industries which will suit this rather than coming up with some big industries actually. That's how you can develop the overall economic scenario of the district. So friends, pardon the technical issue. So the entire case study, the whole slide has not got displayed, just like the previous one. So please friends, I'll anyway read out the case study. You also are aware, you are a municipal commissioner of a large city having the reputation of a very honest and upright officer. A huge multi-purpose mall is under construction in your city, in which a large number of daily wage earners are employed. One night during monsoons, a big chunk of the roof collapsed against causing instant death of 4 laborers, including 2 minors. Many more were seriously injured and requiring immediate medical attention. The mishap resulted in a big hue and cry, forcing the government to institute an inquiry. A preliminary inquiry has revealed a series of anomalies. Material used for the construction was of poor quality. Despite the approved building plans permitting only one basement, an additional basement has been constructed. This was overlooked during the periodic inspections by the building inspector of the municipal corporation. In your inquiry, you noticed that construction of the mall was given the green signal despite encroaching on areas earmarked for a green belt and a slip road in the zonal master plan of the city. The permission to construct the mall was accorded by previous municipal commissioner, who is not only your senior and well known to you professionally but also a good friend. Prima facie, the case appears to be a widespread nexus between officials of municipal corporation and the builders. Your colleagues are putting pressure you to go slow on in the inquiry. The builder, who is rich and influential, happens to be a close relative of a powerful minister in the state cabinet. The builder is persuading you to hush up the matter, promising you to a fortune to do so. He also hinted that if this matter is not resolved at the earliest in his favor, there is somebody in his office who is waiting to file a case against you under POSH Act. Discuss the ethical issues involved in the case. What are the options available to you in this situation? Explain your selected course of action. Again, ethical issues, friends, crony capitalism. There is crony capitalism. Again, there is child labor, violation of rules, conflict of interest because the previous commissioner is your friend. And then there is corruption, possibility of corruption, and there is a false case against an honest civil servant. These are some of the ethical issues. And what are the options available to you, friends? The first option that is available you to go slow on the matter and accept the bribe. The second option is demolish the unauthorized construction and submit the factual report to the higher-ups, book case against the builder. Friends, it is very, very important for you to say that you would demolish the unauthorized construction and submit factual report. See, if you read the case study, so there is a risk that aspirants would get carried away thinking that whether you take action against or not, whether you will write against your senior or not. But the basic problem is there is a violation for which you have to take immediate action. So that has to be written, demolish the unauthorized construction and submit factual report to the higher ups. And because you have to submit a factual report, because you cannot take action against your predecessor, no? So you submit a factual report, let your superiors take a case. And now for the violation, you can very well book case against the builder. That is very, very important. Parmal is a small but underdeveloped district. It has rocky terrain and is not suitable for agriculture, though some subsistence agriculture is being done on small plots of land. The area receives adequate rainfall and has an irrigation canal flowing through it. Amriya, its administrative center, is a medium-sized town. It houses a large district hospital and industrial training institute and some some privately owned skill training centers. It has all the facilities of a district headquarters. A trunk railway line passes approximately 50 kilometers from Amriya. Its poor connectivity is a major reason for the absence of any major industry therein. The state government offers a 10-year tax holiday as an incentive to new industry. In 2010, Anil, an industrial estate, decided to take benefits to set up Amriya Plastic Works in Noora village, about 20 kilometers from Amriya. While the factory was being built, Anil hired the required key labor and got them trained at the skill training centers at Amriya. This act of his made the key personnel very loyal to APW. APW started production in 2011 with the labor drawn fully from Noora village. The villagers were very happy to get employed near their homes and were motivated by the key personnel to meet the production targets with high quality. APW started making large profits, a sizable portion of which was used to improve the quality of life in Noora. By 2016, Noora could boast of a greener village and a renovated village temple. Anil liaised with the local MLA to increase the frequency of the bus service to Amriya. The government also opened a primary health center and primary school at Noora in buildings constructed by APW. APW used its CSR funds to set up women's self-help group, subsidized primary education to the village children, and procure an ambulance for use by its employees and the needy. In 2019, there was a minor fire in APW. It was quickly extinguished as fire safety protocols were in place in the factory. Investigations revealed that the factory had been using electricity in excess of its authorized capacity. This was soon rectified. The next year, due to national lockdown, the requirement of production fell for 4 months. Anil decided that all employees would be paid regularly. He employed them to plant trees and improve the village habitat. APW had developed a reputation of a high quality production and a moat. Critically analyze the story of APW and state the ethical issues involved. Do you consider APW as a role model for development of backward areas? Give reasons. Friends, the first ethical issues. See, if you read this case study, the beauty of this case study is you will find that everything is perfect. Everything is perfect. There are no lacunas on the part of APW. It's like an utopian thing is what you feel when you get that feel. But then you think that what are the ethical issues involved? There are no ethical issues. But friends, the first and foremost thing is the plastic itself is an ethical issue. It's a sin industry. And another thing is CSR, corporate social responsibility, environmental ethics. Of course, APW has been able to plant some trees, and it has been able to create a good village habitats. But we are not very sure whether it is following environmental protocols or not, and also whether they are following labor laws or not. And another issue is they were drawing electricity in excess of the authorized use. That means there was a violation of rule. Thus, these are some of the ethical issues that you can glean very, 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 very carefully. You should see, otherwise you will get carried away by the utopian tone of that case study, friends. Of course, but even then, notwithstanding that, also APW is a role model because it is able to leverage. Why it is a role model? You should say that. Give reasons. They have said the first thing is it is able to leverage the strength of the area because it has large potential workforce. They have been able to impart skills to those workers and they have used it. So, it is like localized development. You are understanding the strengths of an area and you have to create a development model to leverage those skills such that the area becomes developed. Again, it is doing good CSR activities. There is compassion towards weaker sections, and it is not just restricting itself to its business, and it is also taking care of other development activities in the village. And there is localization of development because some industries, what they happen, they bring people from outside and employ. Some industries, what they happen is they bring people from outside and then they employ. But here it is not the case. It is localizing the development, and it is adhering to all the protocols, because even after fire, they could extinguish that fire accident because fire safety protocols were in place. These are some of the components, friends. Coming to the last case study, friends, migrant workers have always remained at the socio-economic margins of our society, silently serving as the instrumental labor force of urban economics. The pandemic has brought them into national focus. On announcement of a countrywide lockdown, a very large number of migrant workers decided to move back from their places of employment to their native villages. The non-availability of transport created its own problems. Added to this was the fear of starvation and inconvenience to their families. This caused the migrant workers to demand wages and transport facilities for returning to their villages. Their mental agony was accentuated by multiple factors such as sudden loss of livelihood, possibility of lack of food, and inability to assist in harvesting their rabi crop due to not being able to reach home in time. Reports of inadequate response of some districts in providing the essential boarding and lodging arrangements along the way multiplied their fears. You have learnt many lessons from this situation when you were asked to oversee the functioning of the district disaster relief force in your district. In your opinion, what ethical issues arose in this current migrant crisis? What do you understand by an ethical caregiving state? What assistance can civil society render to mitigate the sufferings of migrants in similar situations? First ethical issues, friends, is there is lack of compassion towards weaker sections. Second thing is they also have right to life. Third thing is it has brought to the fore the role of civil societies. Like that, you can come up with a few more ethical issues. Then what is meant by ethical caregiving state? Ethical caregiving state should be impartial in its treatment with positive discrimination. but here it is felt that the state was partial towards other labor force, but I mean other citizens, but it was less compassionate and it was not very encouraging, it was not very good towards migrants. Then universal and inclusive care, it against utilitarianism, it's important, friends. So you cannot, an ethical caregiving state will not look for happiness or the development of the largest development of the largest number of populace. It will take care of the development of each and every citizen, friends. Then it would uphold the right to life of every citizen. Then the last question is, what assistance can the civil society render to mitigate the sufferings of migrants in similar situations? So, civil society can run shelter homes, they can provide food, drinking water and milk to kids, they can provide medicines, they can provide other facilities, provision of... Hello friends, thanks a lot for patient hearing. So, and I am extremely thankful for all of you. The whole idea behind this video is twofold, friends. Number one is that I have always felt that after I wrote my ethics book, so I have always felt that I have to keep updating myself and keep updating the aspirants also. So I thought, a discussion on this would help, aspirants to gain new insights into the ethics. And that is the first objective of this session. And the second objective is also, friends, unfortunately, whatever ethics book I have written, so it has become pirated, and the pirated copies are being sold on Amazon and Flipkart also, unfortunately. And the worst part is the pirated copies are of the paper quality is very low and the print quality is also very low. So because of that, the book is getting a little some negative comments also on both on Amazon and Flipkart, friends. So I request you to buy only genuine copies. Friends, genuine copies can be bought on Flipkart from the vendor Arvind India, friends. Flipkart mein it is Arvind India. On Amazon, friends, it is affordable. I request you to buy only genuine copies, and I request you to not to buy pirated copies, because pirated copies quality itself is also bad, friends, and you will also not get the product worth your money. So, and anyway, friends, I thank insightsonindia.com for having given me this opportunity to share my understanding of ethics, and I expect all of you to clear this exam and to become my junior colleagues. So, thank you one and all, and before I sign off, I again reiterate three important things, friends. First one is, please learn to write quick, learn to write fast and finish the paper. Second thing is, please conceptualize your answers as being made up of various components and subcomponents so that examiner would award you more marks. And the third thing is, try to use the common ethical terminology in your questions, like integrity, honesty, impartiality, transparency, accountability, bodily autonomy, something like that. These terms actually will make you very thorough on ethics, friends. So, thank you. Thanks for patient hearing, friends. Thank you one and all.